Hello, welcome everyone. Welcome to Embrace. It's good to see so many friends over the last few weeks. We have 147 people registered for today's event, and we are excited to begin. Just going to let a few more people enter the room. I'm going to share my screen with you. And hopefully all of you have heard about our upcoming event. We have a few events coming soon that we'd like to make sure you're aware of. So welcome everyone to the online panel discussion for planning the 2020-21 visual arts school year. Today we have a panel of visual art and education leaders who are here to share their ideas and strategies for planning and reimagining the upcoming year during the pandemic and recovery. In the weeks ahead, we have a few events that we'd love to just make you aware of. The first is next Wednesday, the Maryland Arts Education Town Hall. We have arts education leaders from NDEO, NAFME, NAEA, and AATE, our national arts education partners, who will be joining us for a panel discussion for the first half of the town hall, moderated by Quanice Floyd of Arts Education and Maryland Schools Alliance and myself. And then the second half will be reflective breakout sessions, really talking about giving the chance for the sector to communicate. We have arts educators, parents, families, teachers, supervisors, superintendents, all in attendance. Dr. Karen Salmon will open the event with an address and opening remarks, and we hope that you all can make it. If you would like to submit questions for the town hall, you can visit our website to do so, and you'll see a link for that in the chat. Today, we'll be referencing a report called the Arts Together Planning Guidance for Arts Educators in Maryland Public Schools. And this is COVID-19 guidance for COVID-19 and a pathway forward. It's a collaborative living document from the Network of Fine Arts Supervisors of Maryland Public Schools. To download that report, please visit our website. There's a link in the chat as well. But you'll find that that report is referenced throughout today's session. And now we're going to begin by bringing up our first panel. Which is comprised of three visionary art leaders. So joining us today will be Michael Bell, Queen Anne's County Public Schools, Sherry Fisher of Baltimore County Public Schools, and Tamara Mills of Worcester County Public Schools. And as they join us, oh, that was so fast. Hello. Hi, Michael. Hi, Sherry.
Hi.
How are you today?
Good.
Yeah, awesome. Yeah. Great. Well, thank you guys for joining us for today's panel. So due to COVID-19 and the very rapid closure of schools, of Maryland schools, local school systems launched right away into continuity of learning plans. And the arts are essential content. They are part of a well-rounded education here in Maryland. Michael, will you tell us what are some of the benefits of making sure that visual arts education continues during continuity of learning?
Sure. One of the single most important benefits for us in Queen Anne's County has been the healing power of art beyond all the evidence-based research on the social emotional learning impact that arts can have on mental health. The arts connect us to our thoughts and our soul as a creative, as opposed to a destructive way to give form and expression to all that life's thrown our way. And I believe what this pandemic has really truly revealed is the need for strengthening our teachers' relationships with their students and providing clarity and creativity during these times. And I'll share this brief example with you that our teachers have reached out to me and said that their use of visual journaling has truly provided them a window into those kids' souls and as a powerful tool to connect kids with their process, but also to inspire hope and belief, which is so important, while guiding them through a series of prompts that were mindful, purposeful, and just, I mean, exploding with fun, which was so cool. So the opportunities that these teachers created, they expanded empathy, joy, self-confidence, and what's more important than that love that they're sharing with their students. So I give the teachers all the credit for all they've done during that.
Absolutely. Teachers are, we've known for a while, teachers are incredible people. And Maryland, we're so lucky to have some of the best teachers in the United States, right?
Yes.
What are you seeing in Baltimore County? How are the arts, the continuation of arts education, how is that benefiting your students over in Baltimore County?
So one of the things that kind of early on, seeing the benefit, seeing my colleagues really get involved with visual arts, seeing that really grow, I stumbled across this image by our British artist Bob and Roberta Smith called We Will Get Through This With Art. And it really became, it's a text-based image, and it really became this like launch pad for thinking about our possibilities. When this all started, the weight of what we could not do was very overwhelming. But we needed to really shift that and think about what could we do. And so we've kept that theme, that thinking about that, to then also think about what are the many ways, not just our students, but our staff members, our parents, our families are really connecting through this and using arts to navigate it. The way we developed our prompts was really thinking about the ways artists work. And we really focused on that and sort of centering, you know, all of the students as, you know, artists, really seeing themselves that way and connect to the world. And it gave them this opportunity to really sort of between the curriculum and the students, it was this great meeting of the moment where they were able to really kind of respond and process. And it really helped us to think about how can we keep this going? Yeah. And that's something to, we've got a large exhibition coming up titled We Will Get Through This With Art that includes families, parents, student work, teacher work, that'll be launched very soon. And we're gonna continue sort of thinking about this as into the summer where our students will be receiving art supplies so that they can continue to process and stay engaged. And because art is a human right, and how do we kind of make that happen for them?
That's fantastic. I love the idea of what can we carry with us forward, right? So just making sure that we're centering big ideas, right? And themes, the visual journaling, we're centering creative practice, we're centering big ideas in arts education as we move forward.
Yeah, we're really creating, you know, starting out with some moments that are very important and groundbreaking that you've created for us here and turning them into movements, which is a big deal.
That is a big deal.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Michael Bell was our first Embrace session. Embrace is our professional learning series that's gotten a lot of attention and a lot of repeat visitors. Tamara, down in Worcester, so it's so great we've got, you know, small, medium, and large with us today. So Tamara, down in Worcester, what are you seeing? How are the visual arts specifically, how are they, what's the benefit of them during this time, during this recovery and continuity of learning time?
So I think for our families, they've really been a lifeline. There's so much, like Sherry was saying, that we haven't been able to do. It's allowed them to focus on the things that they can. In our county, partnerships became invaluable during this time to help kids cope and help families cope. We created partnerships with our local art league and arts council, which we had, but they have strengthened. They came together and provided materials kits for our kids to be able to do art at home, particularly for our homes of poverty where those materials might not be available. And then we also partnered with things like our local hospital. A lot of our Art Honor Society students joined in with a Have a Heart, Give a Hug program where the students actually design a piece of artwork and donate it to the local hospital to thank the frontline workers. And that was a really bonding experience for our kids. We also did something called a collaboration cube where it was a collaborative project with families and students to do with their families where they could use our art and symbolic images in art to create not only what they are doing to cope with their mental health during this time, but also what they're hopeful for. So it gave them that sense of hope. So helping it cope and giving them hope. And that was wonderful. We've gotten over 100 cubes and we're gonna put them all together to create sort of a legacy project that will commemorate this amazingly strange moment in time. And then we're also, this time period and the the way that we're forced to use technology in new ways has allowed us to create a new partnership with our Parks and Rec, even our school system, Arts Council, and Parks and Rec. And we're creating this new partnership called Artline, where through the summer, now we've never done that before, we hope to provide online art lessons once a week. So it's been able to allow community partners to really put emphasis on the arts and then pull in families and children that maybe wouldn't have been a part of those organizations before. So it really became a town, you know, a community time period.
That's terrific. I love hearing that, you know, during uncertain times, your community is coming together. Mm-hmm. Our partnerships are deepening, collaboration is deepening. We've seen that with our supervisor network that we've been collaborating, I think, more than ever before due to the uncertainty of the time. So how wonderful. I also, you know, Nina Simone, who's one of my favorite singers, has a quote. She says that the job of artists really are to share the times, right? To tell the story of the present time, the present moment. Sherry, what are you seeing in Baltimore County? How are student artists capitalizing on the idea of sharing stories through visual art?
So the way we sort of organized the curriculum that teachers are working with during this time is really, we're working in sort of these big ideas. We've started with creative constraints, and then we moved into things like artists responding and documenting their world, to artists telling stories and artists share their work. So I'll tell you a little bit about a lesson that was happening in elementary school over the past 2 weeks. And this has to do with thinking about monuments and what we do and what we honor and how and what kinds of things we want to see. And we started to have this was written weeks ago, and it came at this time that provided our students opportunities to really look at many different things that they were seeing in their world and how they would, what world do they want to build? And the work that came out of it, the depth of thinking from some of our youngest learners was, it would stop you in your tracks. And so it just, it gave a space for students to process things and I wouldn't say safe space, but in terms of in a brave space where they have this opportunity to really use their voice and their skills to give a rich response that many people don't know, that don't give little kids the credit for the great big thoughts that they have. And we've seen that across the board, and we've seen this over and over again. And this shift really, you know, in thinking and expanding, we focused really looking at contemporary artists and a diversity of artists. And we saw our teachers and our students become true partners in learning about new artists, as well as like solving problems. Like, okay, I want to do this. What can I use? What am I going to work with? And and there, for everything that was a challenge, these kinds of moments are things we will keep with us and keep into next year and the years forward. There were some things that we really moved the needle on in this time that we've been trying to for a while. And those are things we want to hold on to.
That's really a great way to think about the time, right? Obviously, due to COVID-19 and of course all of the unrest that's happening in our cities currently, there's a lot of need for, I love this idea of coping and hoping through the arts. I love the idea of this deepening of partnerships. I love what you're talking about, Sherry, that students were exploring big ideas. Even your youngest learners were exploring big ideas and making creative responses that they could share. Michael, what are you seeing in Queen Anne's County?
Well, for us, it's all about finding innovative ways to connect with kids and also help them how to cope, not knowing what supplies kids have at the ready. It's been a way for our teachers to truly get kids to embrace their limitations as that ultimate form of their inspiration. And some of our elementary teachers, this was an interesting one that I found out, that along the way, they found a way to be celebrity guests in their regular classroom teachers Google Meets. So once, you know, they were in there and sharing art, discussing how they could find art all around them, and while also staying home and staying safe, once word spread that the art teachers were coming on a certain day, even siblings started to join in on those meets, and the attendance started skyrocketing. And, you know, that speaks to the power of art and the power of art teachers to help our kids heal and cope as just a beautiful human experience.
That's fantastic. You know, arts teachers are notorious for really grounding a school community, right? Yeah. And so it's good to see that continuing. And Tamara, do you have anything to add about Worcester?
Yeah, I mean, it's a perfect segue to, I was gonna mention, you know, we talked a lot about kids and how we've made, tried to make an impact on the kids during this time. But I think that this impact we've had on the teachers at this time is hopefully a really positive one. In Worcester, we were meeting virtually weekly as a visual arts PLC to have meetings. We broke it down into three parts. We would update, we would give updates, we would have a professional learning experience or information, and then we would network. And so actually it's given me as the coordinator, but also one another, the opportunity to see each other so much more than we would have normally. Mm. So I feel like with the music and the art folks, they've really bonded and sort of have a new relationship with one another that's even more collegial and even more collaborative during this time period. But I think, you know, it's up to us, I guess, as county arts leaders to help facilitate that and help our people grow, because that's what we want. We want our teachers, just like our students, mm-hmm. to continue growing in what they do and be better at it every day. So it's been an interesting opportunity in that respect.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, thank you all three so much for your leadership and for your time today. We are all so grateful for the advanced leadership of Maryland Arts Supervisors. And so we look forward to the weeks ahead in terms of planning and being able to support teachers and students and families. Thank you three. Thanks so much.
Thanks for allowing us to share our stories.
Thank you. All right. Now we're going to bring up two more arts leaders who were, I mean, just absolutely critical to the creation of the Arts Together report. So I'm bringing up to the stage Elizabeth Stewart Whitehead and Amy Shepler. Elizabeth is with Prince George's County Public Schools, and Amy is with Caroline County Public Schools. What's been so clear on the Maryland State Department of Education's Maryland Together report, which many of you have seen, shares that Maryland schools will look very different in fall 2020. And arts instruction is an essential part of a public school education in Maryland and should continue during distance learning, hybrid learning, and in-person learning. Welcome, Amy, and welcome, Lisa. Thank you for joining us today. I want to make sure you both are unmuted, and you are. So, you know, the network, we are all three on the network of Fine Arts Supervisors in Maryland. We are lucky to be a part of that group. And we began as a cohort, right, working on a collaborative document about, I don't know, 5 weeks, 6 weeks ago now, in support of fine arts programs in Maryland public schools. So our next two guests are committee members from the Arts Together report. And the document is meant to be shared with arts education stakeholders and used to launch arts educators into planning for the year ahead, with the understanding that each local school system, of course, will have its own procedures and its own models based on the nature of the pandemic, right? We're rolling out through the state in phases, in roles. I'm over here in Baltimore City. I'm not sure exactly what number of phase we're on today, because it's Friday, but I know that the West has been open much longer than we have, right? So things are rolling out differently. Lisa, the very first element that we've outlined in this report in our executive summary, which I'll pull up in a moment, and you can also find in the chat, says that fine arts educators should continue to teach in their content. Why is that an important piece to make sure that we state even in the executive summary?
Thank you. Yeah, so visual art teachers are really uniquely trained and qualified to be able to teach these visual art courses. And during this kind of unprecedented time, our students need to have access to art education to allow them to process what's happening in their lives. And so something I've been thinking about is that all over the world, how much every human being has been using creativity in their lives, in whatever work situation they're in, you know, during this time of social distancing. Creativity has been like the number one skill that everyone has really been using. And so now is really not the time for us to start figuring out how to not have the arts. It's actually the time for us to start increasing the arts in our schools.
Oh, that's a great point. You know, one of the things I always remember about this time is that I got to dance in a virtual room with Michelle Obama. right? With DJ Nice leading the charge. And some of my favorite singers and artists have opened their homes to us and shared their creative process. And so we really found that during tough times, most of us have spent a lot of time on Netflix in the last few weeks or reading books by beautiful books written by authors or sharpening our skills. So the arts really do help us to cope and to express our thoughts at this time. Amy, we have here for number two that curricular options for all artistic processes. So creating, presenting, responding, and connecting can be delivered in all environments. So that's in-person, hybrid, and remote learning. Why is that so critical to make sure that folks are aware of the overall nature of arts learning at this time?
Oh my gosh. Well, thank you so much for having me today, Alicia. Our teachers here in Caroline have proven that they have been able to adapt and modify their instruction to meet the needs of distance learning. We have become very creative with what supplies students have available to them. And we've discovered that almost anything can be used to create art. And I think the first panel sort of alluded to this a little bit earlier. We've seen some pretty amazing solutions to the creative prompts and problems that we have provided to our students during this time. And to circle back again to the first panel, I just want to reiterate that the creative problems and creative prompts that we provided to our students have really raised their student voices, giving them choice and letting them express anything that's kind of on their mind during these uncertain times. We know that we have some students experiencing some kind of situation. Maybe it's a family situation, a financial situation. They might be living with people they normally don't live with. So just giving them this creative outlet and finding unique and creative materials and tools and letting them share what they've created on their Google Classroom or whatever sort of medium that they have available to them. All of our schools are posting now virtual art shows for the end of the year, and they're available on our Caroline County Public Schools Facebook page. So I think just, you know, we're creative problem solvers by nature. We're artists. That's our job, is to become creative and address any situation that is provided to us. And our teachers here in Caroline have really stepped up to the plate. So I'm very proud to work with all of them.
That does not surprise me in the least. Under your leadership and with that great team that you have there, and you know, industry has known for a long time that folks who continue to create and delve into the creative process are some of the best thinkers of our time, right? So I love that. I love to hear that your teachers are working in that way. Lisa, we heard a little bit from Amy about online exhibitions. Mm-hmm. So during this time, the State Arts Council of Maryland also has put together a report called Best Practices for Digital Engagement. So what are some of the ways that teachers and families can begin to think about student exhibitions and modifications that may need to be made to digital platforms to make sure that student work continues to be displayed?
Yeah, so in Prince George's County, I've had two really big successes with this. One, we were supposed to have our countywide exhibits face-to-face, but that couldn't happen. So we were able to move our countywide exhibit actually pretty quickly to an online platform. And so that's actually on our Prince George's County site. It's up for the whole month of June. And so we had hundreds and hundreds of pieces of work that was submitted to that exhibit. It's actually reaching a lot further than it would have had we had it live. Because now parents and grandparents and aunts and uncles and, you know, all kinds of people all over the world really can now see some of these digital formats and see the amazing work that our students are doing. So I really learned that from now on, I really need to offer both. And that was something that I learned from this. I probably wouldn't have known that otherwise.
Same.
And another really big success that we've had is we've had an art teacher exhibit. And so we've been able to put up works of art from our art teachers. We've had over 75 pieces that were submitted. Our arts council, we partnered with our arts council, and they put up the work on their site. That's also up through the entire month of June.
Someone from Prince George's, please drop that link in the chat. We all want to see that and support that.
Yeah, I have them. So I'll drop them in a little later.
Thank you.
That's amazing. Like if we had had a live exhibit, I'm not sure we would have had, you know, almost 80 pieces of artwork in that show. And so it's really been able to have us really share. We've had professional development on using all kinds of different online platforms for students to be able to share their work and comment on each other's work. And so I'd like to see some of those things kind of going and moving forward as in whatever format we come back to in the fall.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. Amy, we know that there will be a variance in the ways that schools prepare buildings and sanitization policies, but we also believe strongly that teachers and staff need training this summer in how to do this properly, how to properly sanitize materials and physical spaces. And why is that so key for us to make sure that our leaders are understanding the need for that training?
Well, I would first like to start out by just reiterating the fact that visual arts is a critical component to a well-rounded education. So even though this is going to be a little bit challenging, we have to find a way to work through it. There's just no question about it. We are, as visual arts teachers, we are trained in our content area. We are very skilled in teaching students how to draw, paint, use all kinds of mediums. But I would venture to say that most visual arts teachers aren't up to date on the most current best practices for sanitization, both in terms of what materials do we use, what is safe for children and students, what is safe for us to be around, how often should we be doing it. And Caroline, we've also had discussions in conjunction with making sure that our rooms are physically safe for students to be in, but also when you really stop to think about it, in a visual arts classroom, we share so many tools, spaces, even getting your hands in wet clay, like the shared clay bucket, paper mache bucket, all of that good stuff. And the other challenging part of all of this is that COVID-19 is so new, and it seems like it changes almost by the hour. So it's hard to keep straight what will be the best thing for students in terms of cleaning materials and the frequency and all of that good stuff. So it is imperative that our teachers receive some sort of information about making sure that all of our tools and materials and tables and all of that good stuff are clean.
Absolutely. And the report, Arts Together, has some suggestions and recommendations around all of these things, around wet materials and sharing materials, thinking about student supplies. So there are some suggestions there. And as this situation evolves, there'll be more suggestions. So we just ask people to make sure you visit that report, the full report, and visit the visual arts section, which unfortunately is in the back because V, right? It's in alphabetical order, but of course it's absolutely last but not least. Lisa, will you talk to us about student engagement and how we can support student engagement in and through the arts throughout this time? We heard Michael and Tamara and Sherry share about the ways that visual art has been so beneficial to students. And why is it important that we continue to make that a priority in the months ahead?
Yeah, so I really feel like, this isn't really a secret, but even prior to COVID-19, our classes have oftentimes been the sanctuary that the students need to be able to go in and feel successful, to express themselves and be creative. And so that really hasn't changed in terms of that engagement in our classes. Mm-hmm. But a few successes that I've seen is that when we quickly transitioned into distance learning and students were now creating artwork at home, one really great positive of that is that sometimes the entire family gets involved in the art making mm-hmm. process. And I've seen lots of pictures and photographs where the entire family is holding up the sculpture that was created or the design that was created. And how great is it that now we are engaging family members too, who are also in need of having visual art in their lives as well. Yeah. So that's been really, really exciting. I've also, we started a countywide project, and somebody mentioned this on the earlier group, that they are creating artwork to go in the medical centers. And so we had the same thing. Ours was digital. We turn in artwork for the University of Maryland Medical Center. We're actually still doing it throughout the month of June. And it's really been a way for our students to feel like they're making an impact and that they have purpose. And so it's allowing them to really share their thanks and their appreciation for the different medical workers. And those are actually being displayed in the hallways on the TVs of the medical center on a rotating basis. Wow. So they're able to go in and see the thanks from our students for all that they're doing on a daily basis. So that's been really a great way for us to keep our students engaged and to even give them some purpose. That was an extra activity that was not part of their art instruction. And we had many students taking on that extra activity.
That's fantastic. Amy, what else can we expect to see in this report? I mean, this has already been so rich, but what else will we find over in that visual art chapter?
Oh my gosh, we are so excited about the Maryland Arts Together report, particularly the visual arts section. It is difficult to plan for next school year when there are currently so many unknowns with scheduling and COVID-19, et cetera. So the purpose of the report is to provide suggestions and things to consider when planning visual arts classes for the 2021 school year. And the things that are included in here are suggestions and considerations, because what works in Caroline might not work in PGPS or in Baltimore City. So they're just things for arts leaders to think about. The report covers such topics as teaching and learning, maintaining distance, accommodations for smaller student groups, materials and supplies, sanitization, staffing, scheduling, large group gatherings such as art shows, and professional learning. What kind of professional learning will teachers need for the fall? And while there's still many unknowns with regard to next school year, we hope that this document will provide a starting point for districts, schools, and teachers to properly plan their visual arts classes for next year.
Thank you so much. You guys, this has been an incredible journey. This has been, you know, some of the most uncertain times that I'm sure many of us have ever faced, but I'm so thrilled to let everyone know that the Maryland Fine Arts Supervisors have moved forward with it together. And we are stronger, and we're hoping that these resources help arts educators both here in Maryland and around the world. This report, since its download, it was uploaded to our website on June 1st and has been downloaded almost 2,000 times so far. We know that it has been downloaded by at least folks in 38 states so far, and also at this point, 24 countries. So we're really glad that Maryland leadership and collaboration is able to be helpful to so many arts educators around the world. Thank you both for your work on this report. Really grateful to both of you.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for your time today. And now we're going to bring up, we're going to change the conversation a little bit to really think about exhibitions. So of course, all four artistic processes are so important. And in addition to that, we know that exhibiting student work and having a plan for how to exhibit that work is also going to be critical in the days ahead. So we have with us two local Maryland leaders. We have Sarah Newbold, who is the president of Maryland Art Education Association, MAEA, and we also have Keandra Pryor from the Walters Art Museum. So let's start with you, Sarah. Can you tell us, how is MAEA planning for, reimagining, repurposing the 2020-2021 exhibition year?
Well, we've had some initial conversations about what next year might look like, but quite honestly, we haven't made it that many plans yet, just because many of us are still school-based and just trying to get through the rest of the school year first. So actually, that's going to provide opportunities for our stakeholders, our members, to provide lots of input. But we are really trying to pay close attention to the resources we have available to us, like the Arts Together document, messages sent out from the CDC, from, you know, the Fine Arts Office, to sort of keep tabs on what best practices are. Many of our exhibitions and events. We have great partnerships with the Walters, for example, and the Baltimore BWI Thurgood Marshall Airport. So we have to just sort of collaborate with them to, because as much as we love the idea of displaying work online, you know, finding ways to potentially also gather together safely would also be fantastic as well.
Great. Awesome. Thank you so much for sharing that. I thought I saw something online about a MAEA membership.
Yes.
Right. Member art exhibition. Could you tell us a little bit about that? And
yeah. So we are still collecting work for our Maryland Makes Art Museum. It is, we have moved into the realm of digital art or digital exhibitions for both members and students. So feel free to submit your work, and I can put a link in the chat for those that are interested to share. You know, just, you know, myself and a lot of the other members, just being on social media and keeping track of, you know, kind of how people are just passing the time. I know myself, I've been making a lot more art just to sort of help myself get through it. So we thought, well, we should just have a whole exhibition that celebrates all the creativity that our teachers and our educators and our students and that they're making.
That's wonderful. Thank you, Sarah. Keandra over at the Walters. Let me check to see if you're muted. Yep, here we can help you out. There you go.
Okay.
So what's happening at the Walters? How are you guys thinking, not just about your student exhibitions, but the exhibition, your entire collection? What does that look like? How can people engage with that content?
So we do have an online collection, thankfully, that we've had up for quite a while. So that is still accessible, and we're very much engaging, we're trying to engage the public with our collection as best as we can digitally. And part of that has been having online webinars and conversations with about our collection, our curators, and then also trying to engage in a lo-fi way with downloadable documents. So we created this this document called Classroom Connect, which is really focused on the family and student, but still tied to curriculum. And we've distributed those in Baltimore City meal sites. So they're printed documents and are connected to language arts and visual arts learning. And so I would second what Sherry said earlier about really pushing us to kind of stretch ourselves in ways that we knew we needed to, but this moment has really made us commit to things that we've always said that we needed to do, like being, not being bounded by our walls completely and really being responsive to community and really listening to our partners. Like, this situation has really made us a lot more flexible in those ways. As far as our exhibitions, the summer exhibitions have been moved to next year, and it's still really unfolding. The curatorial team is working really hard on figuring that out in response to COVID-19. We are still closed, and we won't be reopening until, like you said, we're in Baltimore City. So we're one of the slowest opening counties in Maryland. So we're still waiting to hear where we are in which phase, which we believe will be in phase three somewhere after schools become open again. So in that way, we know that in the fall, we probably won't have in-person necessarily student art exhibitions, we think. We're really not sure, and we're all being really flexible and trying to be responsive. But one thing that we know is that the student art exhibitions aren't just about the art being up on the wall. I think we've been thinking about it in three ways, that it's about that sense of honor, that feeling of being in the sculpture court and seeing your art amongst the world's greatest artists. It's a part of recognizing not only the students, but the teachers and the families. And so in that way, I think we can still honor teachers and students and really give voice to the work that you all are doing, which is incredible. I think we've been in awe of the teachers, the administrators that really have like not stopped. You guys, you're really incredible. We're really just trying to keep up with you. So I think that's one way we've discussed with our partners with continuing the feelings and the modes around that and remembering that that is equally important to making sure that the students are recognized. So if that means utilizing our social media or our website to just promote the work that's already being done. That's been really important to us is like not duplicating and replicating, but giving voice to those that are on the ground doing the work. So, you know, hearing Sarah say, you know, you guys are all educators. You're in the classroom, you're working hard. It's really hard to figure out all these things at the same time where you're swamped with all this other work. So our role, we believe right now, is to listen, but not just to listen and wait, but to listen and respond. And so that's really been driving our work right now. But Sarah, what you were saying before about this community piece is really important. Like, what are we missing by not coming together? And that's the part that we're really trying to figure out. How can we make sure that that community is still there, that they very much know that you are us and we are you. So the museum is not anything without you. So how do we make sure that that is recognized in this interim moment, whether that means having our own digital online exhibition platform that's been floated, or it means that we show up in your spaces in a more prominent way. And we're really trying to figure that out, to be honest, but we'll definitely keep you in the loop. We're trying, we're really flexing our, like, we're an old institution. We all are part of an old, like, big institution, but really trying to be nimble in ways that we haven't been for a while.
We're all grateful for that. And I think that is so important, this idea of being nimble, but also, you know, we all have to be so flexible. I don't remember who it was that already today said the virus has changed. I don't know about that, but that we, our knowledge of it has changed. And so ways that we can protect ourselves changes, and that may continue. So we just have to be so flexible. Thank you so much for being so responsive. Will you talk about ways that you're making sure that your community, whoever you guys consider community or constituents, how are you communicating that message to them that we'll need to be flexible and in the days ahead? How is that working, Sarah? What's happening with MAEA and your communications?
Well, we have a really fantastic team of a communications committee, and they are always trying to be really responsive through social media platforms, you know, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and then also we communicate a lot through email. I try to send out periodic messages, you know, just keeping everyone informed about opportunities and information in terms of what's going on with our organization. We also have monthly meetings that, quite frankly, are open online to all of our members. The next one is on June 22nd. So we are going to be having a lot of discussions about the upcoming year in terms of, you know, what our conference may look like, what our exhibitions may look like. So we really do want everyone's input. And so we have moved to a digital platform. We actually started that a couple of years ago because we realized how big Maryland is. And so while a lot of us may get together in person, because I mean, I commute an hour to get to the meetings, but I just enjoy that sense of community. But you know, now that we can't get together in person, you know, having that option and in already sort of having that comfort in discussing things digitally over Zoom has really been helpful in terms of keeping our community together and keeping us in touch. So I would encourage our art educators to join us on June 22nd. I will be sending out a reminder email, and you can look for us on social media. But you know, we really do want to get everybody's input as we move forward.
Right. You know, at this time, if you are an art educator and you're not signed up with the MSD Fine Arts Office and your MAEA on social media, now's a good time to do that. you know, just to stay in the loop in terms of the new, I would say the new expanded way we're all thinking about our state as a vast connected network, because we're all networked online. Mm-hmm. Yes, Keandra and Sarah, thank you so much for your time today. It's been so wonderful to hear the perspectives of both of your institutions. Thank you.
Thank you
for your leadership. Okay. And, you know, just to remind everyone that the Maryland's fine arts educators across our state should be supported in creating exhibits, showcases, performances, concerts, et cetera, that can be delivered in a remote environment and or maintain physical distance in person for face-to-face. Presenting as defined in our Maryland Fine Arts Standards can be delivered utilizing digital tools, remote learning platforms, and other methods that allow for sharing and showing of work while following local regulations. If you're looking for examples, please do visit our website, where you'll find lots of examples through our Arts Together report. And now for our final panel, I'm going to bring up two artists to the stage, and we are so lucky to have them with us. And these are two artists that are local to Maryland and also educators as well. So I am bringing up Ernest Shaw and James Williams II. I'm hoping I'll be able to. Perfect. Yay, worked out. Hello, Ernest.
Hello, how you doing?
Great. How are you? Hello, James. How are you?
I'm good. How are you doing?
Oh, good. You got kitties at home. We love that.
Yep, you probably hear them.
Good. That's great. We love that. That's awesome. So, hello, Ernest and James. You two are both Baltimore-based visual artists, and it's really great to have you with us. I'm going to talk to Ernest first. I'm just going to mute you just a little bit, and I'll connect back to you. Okay, James? So, Ernest, will you talk to us about your creative practice? And I have this painting here on display. This is a painting that gained so much notoriety, again, during a time of uncertainty and pain and trauma. You turned to your artwork to express some ideas around the passing of Mrs. Morrison. Will you talk to us about your work and what you do, your creative practice, and what you do?
Okay, well, I'm mostly a portrait and figurative painter. The overwhelming majority of my images are of people throughout the African diaspora, either African American, if you use that term, or maybe from the Central South America, Caribbean, continent of Africa. And most of my work deals with that experience and the complexities and nuances of those experiences historically and culturally.
Wonderful. And you have a lot of very, I would say, iconic murals here in Baltimore City. Mm-hmm. And will you talk to us about how do those murals come together? Are they things where you just come with an idea? How do you figure out how to make those murals come to life?
Well, more often than not, a community or community organization, someone approaches an artist, and it is totally a collaborative effort. I may have ideas relative to whatever the community would like to express, but there's several stages, and in each stage there's different iterations of a design, you know, amendments made to a design, so that you can, or the artist can, to the best of their ability, provide imagery and work that expresses the needs and wants of said community.
Thank you so much. And James, will you tell us a little bit about your work? I'm gonna share an image.
So my work, similar to Ernest, I am a figurative artist. I have always been a figurative artist, and much of my work is mostly seen in a communal way when you're visiting galleries or spaces that are open to the public in that sense. In the past, I did do some public art, but mostly what I think people know my work for is the paintings that are displayed in certain galleries. My work really revolves around a conversation or conversations both present in future with my oldest daughter, Indigo. When she was four, we had many conversations about race, racism, and just her placement in the world. And so that conversation kind of spiraled into the work. The work before then had always talked about race and identity, but I think it became more clear to me my understanding of race through her eyes. Questions that we sometimes forget are really simple in its answer, that adults make it so complex. And children kind of hold you accountable. They'll say things like, well, why is this? Or why not that? And there's some clear places where I'm like, I don't know. And so the work in itself is really an expression of those conversations. There are some conversations I just have yet to have with her due to her inability to be able to take it all in. And I think I'd still want her to be a child. But these paintings are coming from that. And so it's really my journey, I guess. I've been making work for a very long time. And this, I think, it becomes the most personal work that I've shown in a while.
Yeah, thank you so much. Is there a title for this painting that I have on display here?
That painting is a painting I did, I guess 2 weeks ago. And it's called Prom King. Most of the paintings or the paintings that you will see will be, instead of a collective experience of the Black community, it's mostly my experience as a Black community. Again, this is a conversation I'm having with my daughter, and I think what can sometimes present, I think, is the lack of individuality in the Black community. I do think that style and things are important, but the Prom King in the title itself had spoke to me in a certain time that I, you know, have shared with my daughter about certain things.
Thank you, James. Ernest, will you talk to us about the ways, you're an educator, Baltimore City Public Schools educator. Will you talk to the ways that COVID-19 and also the unrest that's happening currently with so many protests? There was a student protest led by student artists from Baltimore School for the Arts, which I think you have a connection there. Will you talk to us about the ways that that has impacted your teaching and learning? What have you seen? How has teaching and learning changed for you in the weeks past?
Well, one of the things we are aware that distance learning is not necessarily a new phenomenon, right? However, this is a little different because there's a need for a paradigm shift across the board. So there's research that suggests, and I said this on a different Zoom or a different panel, that almost 80% of what influences our children comes from the internet, comes from technology. So that leaves 20% for whom? Parents, the community, radio, that's not television, you know what I mean? Radio.
Wow.
So where does the teacher fall in that? So then I had to self-assess and say, this is an opportunity for me to become a part of that almost 80%.
Wow.
Again, a need for a paradigm shift.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm an educator, but I'm also a Black man that grew up in a neighborhood very similar to, if not the same neighborhood as many of my students. I teach over 97% African-American student population. So, where does my job as an educator and then the rest of my life, where does that intersect? Or is that one and the same?
Yeah.
All this is part of the self-assessing process.
Yeah.
So due to COVID, due to our current state of affairs, you know, it's allowed me to be even more of myself in ways where it's difficult to be a Black man within public school education. And that's just a reality. So this has allowed me to be more of myself as a father, as an educator, an artist, someone who identifies themselves as Black, you know, within the context of public education.
That's really interesting. I hear you saying, just talking about reflection, and it's so important to me that we just hear that, you know, part of being an artist is the reflection process. Artists are reflective people who are constantly doing self-assessment, not just in the art making, but in life. So I love when I hear that every time I talk to an artist, we talk about reflection. I love to hear that. Jim, can you share with us a little bit about the work that you are doing with your daughter Indigo specifically around the way that even the engagement will look a little differently. You talked to me a couple days ago about the actual exhibit space being more suited for
young people. Actually, I kind of lost some of what you were saying. Forgive me. Did you say that one more time?
Sure. Will you talk to us briefly about the art exhibit that you have that's approaching, that is a combination with you and Indigo?
Yes,
and the ways that you're thinking about even in the exhibition, making it more child friendly.
So another thing. So I'm an educator. I'm an artist, but I'm also a curator. It's been a while, honestly, for me to have curating a couple of shows. It had planned on being some shows this June and then one in September, which was the one that you're referring to. Mm-hmm. That show is getting pushed back until next year upon my request. But it's with a museum in Virginia. And I was reached from a person who I trust and understood their vision, and what they gave me was more or less that I could have half the museum. And what I found was that I wanted to take this opportunity, and this is something that we had planned about a year ago, to provide more voices than just my own, especially in museum format. I wanted us to focus on programming. And one of the things I've always wanted to do for the longest time was give my daughter Indigo an opportunity to be present in a space such as a museum. And not only that, but to also create more opportunities for younger generations to be able to be present in the museum. It's hard as a parent going to galleries where you just can't have children. And though it might not be said, the space is not open enough for a diverse group of people. And you will find that museums. Museums are prepared for that through programming. But galleries, I think, has more of a heart, I think, to Baltimore City. I think that's where you see some really amazing conversations happening that just might not happen in museums. And so I wanted to provide that in this museum. And so the idea was to have parents and their children be shown in the museum, along with my daughter, Indigo. The work to be hung at the height of children, and for it to be centered, focused around the children. The parents are there as support, but really that other half or the other quarter of that museum is meant for the children to be shown beside their parents, and for it to be an opportunity for them to realize that their art is worth, has a value, because I think it's also important that it's through education that we begin to see art providing value based on the knowledge that we know. But children don't need that. You know, my daughter is impressed with her painting or her drawing, and she just needs her dad or her mom to say, this is amazing. It's when we begin to think that everything that has theory and has these heavy notions behind it that we think has more value. But I think to encourage our children, especially now in this time and day, is to let them know that no matter what they say, no matter what they do, it's special. And to put that into museum, I think, is more important than ever.
Yeah, thank you so much. That's fantastic, James. I wanted to make sure we were able to share that. We only have time for one more comment. Ernest, will you just share with us this summer, as an educator, what are some of the things that you are preparing to, in terms of thinking about leveling up your pedagogy? I know you're always thinking about leveling up. What are some of the ideas that you're thinking that you just want to make sure that you're getting new skills that you want to acquire over the summer so we can all show up differently for our students in the fall?
Well, one thing, full transparency, I'm trained on the college level.
Mm-hmm.
I have training to be a distance learning adjunct professor.
Oh, how fantastic.
Having said that, I cannot keep up with my students relative to the new technology that comes out. So I am going to be engaging in taking some lessons and some courses on not just teaching online, but also on creative programs like Photoshop, InDesign, you know, the Adobe Suite, and then other programs that are free programs that our students can download to their phones or their tablets.
Great.
So they can continue to create and learn when at home, as well as in the classroom.
That's fantastic. Thank you so much. Thank you to both of you. Thank you, Ernest. Thank you, James. Thank you so much. And we look forward to working with you more in the future. Ernest and I have a we have a lunch date that we're going to keep to get some plans going and brewing for some work with teachers, hopefully maybe even later this summer. So thank you to both of you. Thank you so much. All right, everyone, I'm going to close us out. I just want to make sure everyone is aware that this summer is a great time to continue learning. Of course, as teachers, we never stop learning, but to continue learning. And the Maryland State Department of Education's Fine Arts Office, in collaboration with our network of supervisors, are planning a really robust summer ahead that looks at building out our information base around mental health, social emotional learning, culturally responsive art education, arts integration, and all of the framework pieces that have to go with supporting an arts education that is robust, specifically in reaction and response to our time here through COVID, and of course, also the uprisings throughout our country. So we thank you so much, and we hope you'll join us this summer. As I just want to always mention, thank you to the supervisors for your collaborative nature, your generosity. So many of you showed up today in the chat and are supporting all of the presenters. So we're so grateful to all of you. Thank you to all of our presenters today for preparing such a robust presentation. We're really glad to have been able to do that. And please download the Arts Together report and check out that visual art section, that visual art chapter, and join us next Wednesday at the Maryland Arts Education Town Hall. Thank you for your time. Well, next week, we will have a panel of dance education artists and educators and supervisors. So please spread the word to your fellow dance colleagues to meet us here next week. And we'll see you soon. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.